Hey guys, it's Danielle again with Pure Root Wellness. Back in the office here, and let's talk a little bit about dairy. So this topic is, what's the scoop on dairy? See what I did there? Really, so what's considered dairy? The definition itself is food, any food produced from the milk of animals, right? So you're looking at milk, egg, cheese, butter, ice cream, any creams, you know, creamer, heavy cream, yogurt, custards, and then a lot of times people don't see or understand, I guess, what is whey and casein and rennet. These are all actual milk products or milk, part of the milk process, or dairy product, I should say. I shouldn't say milk, but they come from milk. And whey is actually the liquid that remains after the milk has been curdled or strained. Casein is the protein, actually, from that milk that forms kind of the basis of like a cheese. And then rennet is the enzyme that helps kind of produce the curdling of the casein in the milk to actually form the cheese itself. So there's a lot of kind of different enzymatic processes and things that still are considered a dairy product. And what I found kind of interesting, just because once I kind of found out and figured out what whey was, you know, at one point in my life, I was an athlete, I was a gymnast, I was a softball player, you know, pretty decent athlete. And, you know, you take your protein, right? And it's whey protein, and you got to have the whey protein because it builds muscle and it, you know, helps you get through your workouts and blah, blah, blah. So I started kind of looking at the breakdown of whey, and whey is just really, you know, amino acids, beta-lactoglobulin, alpha-lactalbumin, immunoglobulins, bovine, which is like cow, serum albumin, lactoferrin, a lot of these kind of processes or what should I say, enzymes and products that make up the amino acid of whey and the protein. There's different types of forms of whey protein, which is interesting. Whey concentrate is actually the least processed. Whey isolate is the most minimal percentage or no lactose at all. And then whey hydrolyzate is the most expensive, but it's actually the best type of whey due to its quick absorbable peptides and then minimal fat and lactose content. But again, you're going to pay more for, you know, kind of this better kind of product, I should say. One interesting article that I found, they were talking about, you know, a warning for protein powder, and one of these nonprofit groups called the Clean Label Project actually released a report talking about all the toxins that were in protein powders. When they looked at about 134 products, 130 of those products had toxins in the protein powder that included heavy metals, so lead, arsenic, mercury, BPAs, pesticides, all of these things that are contaminants basically linked to cancer and other health conditions. So it's not without saying that, you know, if you're on the protein powder kick and it's something that you feel helps supplement your diet, your workout, your energy, you know, you like the taste of it, that's awesome. My suggestion would just be to find something possibly with whey hydrolyzate in it, and really be clear that you're buying a product that's not processed and doesn't have all of these additional chemicals in it. Just do your homework, I guess, is the take home. But let's really look at dairy in itself, right? So, you know, we use, as a mother, you know, I produced milk, okay? I did the best I could with breastfeeding my child for as long as I could, just, you know, for the health purposes of it, obviously. But mamas use their breast milk for growing 7-pound babies into 25 plus pound toddlers. My kid, he's ginormous. I could be the breast milk. He's just a solid hodge of a kid. Anyway, about around 2 years old, we stopped giving mama's milk to babies, right? You know, kiddos got to start eating real food. They can get their protein from other sources. They start, you know, actually engulfing food that's appropriate to their age range. You know, they want to eat that stuff. And not to say if you obviously breastfeed your child longer than 2 years of age, more power to you. Again, you know, they're still getting all the good stuff as long as you're healthy and passing on those good immunoglobulins and all the good factors that are sustained in breast milk. But now look at like a mama cow, right? A mama cow needs to grow a 90-pound calf. Okay, these things come out 90 pounds into a 2,000-pound cow after about 2 years. So let's really think of the size difference here and the physiology of this. I guess my question is, why would I need cow's milk for my child who's 7 pounds or even, you know, as a toddler? Let's say he's already 25 pounds. The cow's milk's job is to turn this 90-pound calf into a 2,000-pound cow. The rapid growth that happens in lieu of that is not equivocal to what humans, how humans need to grow and the exponential rate that humans need to grow, right? And even like the physiology of it itself, the anatomy. I mean, humans have one stomach, cows have four. But this is what gets me. Cows, yes, they drink their mama's milk up until a certain point, and thereafter they eat grass. They're herbivores, right? They only eat grass, at least the free range ones run, right? How can something so big and muscular and hardy sustain a diet just on grass alone? Well, that's the same concept with a vegetarian or a vegan or you know, a plant-based diet, right? You can be just as strong as a 2,000-pound animal. I'm being facetious, but I'm just saying a 2,000-pound animal doesn't wither away and die when it's eating grass because the plants themselves provide enough of the protein and the nutrients and what have you. So that's kind of all I'm talking about with that. But by 18 months to 14 years, we ourselves as humans lose about 90 to 95% of the lactase enzyme to digest lactose. That's the sugar in dairy. That's what lactose means, is the sugar in the dairy product. And you know, we're the only species on the planet that drinks milk as adults. Let's just be honest here. There's no other species that does this. So why? Why are we deciding to do it? Maybe it tastes good. Maybe you like the taste of milk. That's awesome. But my point is, it holds not a lot of nutritional clout as an adult to drink milk, period. And this lactose that we talk about and losing 90 to 95% of the lactase enzyme to digest this lactose, you know, 65% of the world's population is unable to digest that lactose, the sugar. And if you try, you get the bloating, the discomfort, the stomach pains. That was me, straight up. Like, I never realized it until I maybe hit, I don't know, my like late 20s, 30s, where I was like, if I went and had some ice cream, I'm talking like a decent size ice cream, I was hurting. It was bad news bears. And I finally realized that it's not that it was an allergy, it's not that it was even an intolerance, it was more just, I mean, it could necessarily be an intolerance, it was just my body couldn't digest it and couldn't get rid of it. And I paid for it, you know. So if you're having these, you know, you eat a meal with dairy in it, and then you're bloated and you're uncomfortable, and digestively you're having diarrhea, you're having all these issues, just stop, think about it. Look at your food. What are you eating? What kind of dairy product is in your food? And I promise you, if you eliminate it, just for give it 7 days, you hands down will probably see a difference in how you feel, specifically with that food group. So, and you know, it's not just, I mean, even reading this, 95% of Asians, you know, are unable to digest this lactose. 60 to 80% of African Americans, you know, it's Hispanics and American Indians and you know, Jewish descent. All of these people, their enzymes have evolved. Basically, their body has evolved to not be able to digest this for a reason. And the reality is, it just doesn't hold that good nutritional clout that you're looking for. So, kind of the truth, right? So what we've been told about dairy, you need milk for strong bones and teeth. It's a good source of protein. Athletes drink milk. It does the body good. All these things, right? This was unfortunately a marketing ploy back in the day. This was not backed up by any evidence-based research. Oh, you need to drink 3 glasses of milk a day. It has no sustainability from a research standpoint. It was literally just marketing to promote the dairy world and the dairy farmers and you know the money that could be made off of it, unfortunately. And the research actually shows, I'm going to go into each bullet point here, but the research actually does show that dairy will increase osteoporosis in the countries who consume the most dairy. So US, Sweden, Finland, these are countries with the highest rate of osteoporosis. And this is coming from like Harvard, Yale, like New England Journal of Medicine. This is not like phooey, like, hey, some hippie like myself in her basement was like, quit drinking dairy, quit drinking milk, quit having all the things. Like, those countries, those three countries, were the top three who consumed the most animal product, including milk or dairy. A study of over like 96,000 people over 22 years. This is not an itty bitty study, right? Showed that milk consumption during teenage years didn't actually protect against osteoporosis. And men who drank more milk had an increased risk of actual bone fractures, heart disease, cancer, and premature death. That's wild, right? Like everything we thought it would do, like beneficial wise, it's the polar opposite. And even coming from the US Drug Administration, you know, 3 glasses of milk, drink your 3 glasses of milk. Researchers, even in this department, are saying this is just way too much. This is not a thing. This shouldn't be a thing. So if you listen to the other podcast called I Got the Meat Sweats, I talk about the antibiotics, the pesticides, the hormones in the factory farmed animals, right? The reality is, and this is records coming from the FDA, again, not a rinky-dinky, like, no-name, you know, entity, showed that at least almost, I should say, 100% of the cheese products that are actually produced in the United States have some detectable pesticide residues. So it's there. I mean, people are saying it and they're putting out in the world. It's just not enough people know about it. Or, and don't get me wrong, I like cheese is a tough one for me. Like guilty. I love cheese. Cheese has been the hardest thing for me to ever say no thank you to. When I was vegan for a hot sec, it was very challenging to find a good cheese product. And towards the end of this, you know, podcast, I'll give you some actual like images of some of the best like vegan non-dairy products that I've found out of just, you know, trial and error. But if you're telling me I have all these detectable pesticides and pretty much any piece of cheese or roughly close to any piece of cheese that I consume within the United States, that's wild. Like, you know, I'm actively choosing to just eat pesticides, which is kind of sad to think about. But for me too, it's almost like we need to think about what's happening to the cow, right? And the dairy that's being consumed and you know, a machine hooks up to the other udder, and this isn't somebody just sitting on a little stool and having a great day and milking and doing all the things. You know, a machine is hooked up to the cow's udder. The udders start to become sore, bleed, cracked, pus can form, pus and blood end up in the milk, hence, you know, or poop on the udders, hence why we have to pasteurize the product, right? The horrible thing is when we pasteurize and we do all kind of the cleaning properties of it to make sure it's actually safe to drink, we lose a lot of the protein content that goes into that, or that I guess should be in the milk that no longer is in the milk. The hormones themselves, you know, the man-made hormones such as the recombinant bovine growth hormone, that's given to cows to increase their milk production, right? Antibiotics used to treat the udder infections, the mastitis in the cows. Traces of these antibiotics are found in the milk and in the dairy products. You know, it's the pesticides, the PCBs, the dioxins, all of these, they're in the product. You just can't remove them. So, you know, I think with a buildup of time of all of these products and everyone saying, keep drinking your milk, keep drinking your milk, we're giving it to kids in the schools. You know, it's like, it just doesn't make sense to me. You know, when you can have an almond milk, an oat milk, a hemp milk, you know, all of these options out there that offer better nutritional content and still allow the child to grow appropriate. Like I said, I mean, for me, once I stopped breastfeeding, it was, and my child begged for almond milk, the unsweetened and the vanilla and the chocolate, the chocolate almond silk chocolate. I mean, he like begs for it, and he doesn't know the difference. The reality is, he just doesn't know the difference because that's what he's drank his whole life. And again, like I said, my child is like 98 percentile in height and weight, a healthy height and weight, you know, a healthy BMI. So it's one of those where, you know, I think if done right and correctly, you won't have that scrawny kid, thinking that you're, you know, missing out on giving your child milk to have them grow. And then obviously another truth is, you know, the dairy itself has less small chain fatty acids, which, you know, in another podcast, we talk strictly about short chain fatty acids and how this helps keep the good bacteria healthy, the bad gut bacteria kind of suppressed. But dairy can also really increase your intestinal permeability. Again, leaky gut, another podcast that we talk about what is leaky gut. But you know, you're opening up these junctions in the cells. Like literally, the cells come apart because you've broken down your inner barrier of your intestinal tract. The lining of the inner part of the pipes is just completely gone and eroded from just junk, crappy foods. And then the dairy itself helps to increase that permeability and eventually lead to, you know, worse outcomes, basically gut inflammation, possibly autoimmune disease processes, not good stuff, right? And then an increase of TMAO, which again, I'll talk about in another podcast more specifically in detail. But this is what the gut bacteria produces, basically. It's an end product after eating a red meat, energy drinks, supplements, dairy, and it really puts you at increased risk for heart disease, stroke, Alzheimer's, diabetes, chronic kidney disease, AFib, CHF. Like, it's linked to some serious comorbidity issues. So again, I know people say they've grown up on milk, they love milk, they feel strong and healthy on it, but the research is truly saying otherwise, guys. I mean, I don't know how else to kind of, you know, break it down, unfortunately. So let's talk a little bit about the vitamins that are in the milk itself. Calcium is always an important one. Milk does have a lot of calcium. I will give it that. I don't deny that at all. It's an important mineral to obviously keep the bones strong. But there's other ways of obviously getting calcium through, you know, vegetables, fruits, vegetables per se, you know, leafy greens, things like that. You don't necessarily just need to drink milk for the calcium. I promise you, you'll get it in other plant-based option foods if you just kind of do your research. Milk does have vitamin K, which activates the proteins for bone formation. Vitamin K comes in two different forms, K1, K2. K1 is found in the green leafy kind of vegetables, broccolis and stuff, and K2 is what's predominantly produced by bacteria. And these obviously are found in dairy products, pork, poultry, fermented foods. So again, you know, if you're getting it from a meat source, okay, be smart, or an animal protein source, I think you just need to be smart and limit how much. If you're giving me an option of getting vitamin K through fermented foods as well and green leafy vegetables, I'll choose that every day, all day, just because I know the quality of nutrients and the more bang for my buck that I'm getting. And then vitamin D. The vitamin D helps to actually absorb the calcium. Funny enough, milk does not naturally have the vitamin D. It's actually fortified with it. So if someone says, you know, oh, you know, the milk and it has vitamin D in it, well, we put that there. We, meaning the royal we, the companies, the dairy, you know, entities themselves put that there and was fortified with it. Really the best natural source of vitamin D is sunshine. Go sit outside for 15 minutes and you know, just relax and chill, and you got your vitamin D. What I did find was interesting, though, was animal protein actually was found to suppress the production of the active form of vitamin D, which is the 1,25-dihydroxyvitamin D. So, again, it's like they're telling you to drink milk for all these, you know, vitamins and things, but the reality is it actually suppresses your production of certain vitamins, and you know, it just, it's, you're not going to get what you think you're going to get out of with dairy products alone. And one study actually analyzed data from a large nurse health study, which, of course, why wouldn't I love that, being, you know, starting out as a nurse myself, found that women who consumed less than 190 micrograms of vitamin K were more likely to break a hip. So vitamin K actually is maybe a little more important than, I shouldn't say more important, that's a horrible way to say it because I like all of the vitamins. Vitamin K is very important for the osteoporosis standpoint versus the calcium, the vitamin D, you know, are all three important, absolutely, but it looks like vitamin K could be a large proponent of protecting bones and preventing fractures. So just kind of, again, I'm like a visual person, so cow milk versus almond milk, side by side, right? Almond milk wins every single time except for the protein, right? You're looking at 8 grams versus 1 gram. To me, that doesn't bother me, that I will get my protein from other sources, leafy greens, you know, seeds, nuts, berries, you know, my tofu. I don't have a problem getting protein. To me, if I'm going to have something with milk, almond milk in it, I'm looking at less calories, less fat, less carbs, no sugar, and more calcium. It's a no-brainer. I'll get my protein from another source. You know, you can't, it's really, you know, kind of right in front of your face right there as to why you should be choosing a milk alternative versus actual cow's milk. So the take home, just start little by little reducing your dairy intake. For me, like I said, it was challenging at first. I didn't have a problem ditching the milk. That's the first choice. Get rid of milk. If you can't part with your butter right now, if you can't part with your trip to the ice cream shop, again, guilty as charged, cheese, I am a sucker for cheese all day, every day. That's the hardest part for me. I can say no thank you to pretty much everything else, but the cheese has always just been a challenge for me, just because for me, it tastes so dang good. you know, if you choose to eat dairy products, the best are the fermented milk products. So kefir, fermented yogurts, I hate to say it, plain and boring with minimal sugar. You know, you start looking at yogurts where you're like, okay, you know, it's fermented, it's good protein. They have tons of sugar in them, like tons if you look at them. So you're going to have to go plain and boring. And just doctor them up with fruit and you know, some other natural sweet tasting products, but be careful with that. And then fermented cheeses are actually the best cheeses if you're gonna reach for a cheese. Feta, Swiss, Gouda, Parmesan, provolone, sour cream even, those would be better options. But first start with the milk, get rid of the milk. Get rid of the milk. Just go to the fridge now, toss it. Go to the store, try 3 different brands of almond milk or oat milk. You know, me, I'll show you my brands here in a minute that I like. For me, taste the closest to the real deal, Holyfield. But get rid of the milk. Legit, get rid of the milk right now. Look at the labels. Boring, yes. But seriously, you'll be shocked at how much of your processed food has whey, casein, or milk powder in them. Stop buying that crap. It's processed. How can you put milk in crackers and all these things and expect it to have a shelf life of however long, months? What did they do to it to make it be able to sustain that amount of time with having a dairy product or a milk product in it? No bueno. So just start looking at labels. You'll be absolutely shocked. Try some dairy alternatives, like I said. You will notice the difference. Cheese for sure. But milks, butters, creamers, soy, pea protein powders, literally all of it tastes the same. I promise you. Like back in the day when I first started becoming a vegetarian and started using alternative ways of my dairies and my meats and all the things, it was not good. Things, the taste alone, I was just like, I can't do this, but I stuck with it. And as the need for all of these meat alternatives and dairy alternatives came about, it's like literally I cook for my husband and child, and half the time they don't notice the difference. It just takes time, and you've got to, experiment a little bit. For me, just real quick, this was like a picture. I wanted to put a picture of everything that I enjoy to get the same kind of taste. I like to make my own like salad dressings and stuff. That Veganaise Follow Your Heart is hands down by far, I like it better than just regular mayonnaise, period. It's like creamy, it's got great flavor, good salty taste. It's the bomb. And then the Follow Your Heart cheeses and the chow cheeses, or the field roast cheeses, I should say, are probably the best. Melted is obviously better than plain, but these Just Eggs, they're bomb diggity. I mean, best eggs. You can make an egg sandwich, egg sausage sandwich in the morning, and you literally won't notice the difference. And then those were Silk for me, the almond milks right there, the chocolate. My child just begs for it, just absolutely begs for it. It's that good, so. And then my last page, if you guys want to look at it, as my references. But think about what you're consuming from dairy product standpoint. Think about what you're putting in your body. Think about, if it's from an animal perspective. A lot of people have health ailments with the bloating and the digestive issues and all these things. The reality is a good fair majority of it stems from just removing the dairy products. A lot of times, though, you just don't know that you're eating it. Like I said, with the processed foods and what's in what, just start paying attention a little bit and start just plucking a few things out here and there. But like I said, the first thing to go, get rid of the milk. Just try it. Try it for 7 days and try something else. And I promise you, you'll start plucking away at some other stuff once you kind of start learning what you like and using the dairy alternatives. So that's it for today. I hope this podcast was helpful, and be well, friends.